Hello, Case.
Hey, Emerson. Good to see
So,
you.
so tell me the story of Case.
Yeah, the story of Case. Well,
Yeah. Oof.
where to begin? Yeah, story of Case. I think to start with a little bit of context is, for me, I've always had a sort of spiritual inclination.
Yeah.
So when I was a young kid, I was already fascinated with churches, for example, right?
Yeah,
And
yeah.
like books and wisdom and I had, like, maybe you could even say, like, sort of past life memories, whatever is a past life, I don't know. So yeah, always interested in that. And then I think I forgot about all that and went into, like, puberty, like trying to
Yeah.
sort of, with a lot of conditioning, trying to sort of prove myself. So I
Yeah.
think my inclination was a little bit to prove myself, and to that led me actually to personal development.
Yeah. Yeah.
And from personal development, it started with, like, trying to get better with girls, for example. Things like that. And then in that whole sort of
How do
getting
I
better
get
with,
more dates? That
And in that, they had sort of either you tr pretend to be this fake cool guy,
kind
or they were like, you actually work on yourself. So
of
basically, also with, like, meditation, maybe, or
thing,
with like all these things. And then at some point, I met a girlfriend. So basically, there was nothing left in that seeking, you could say, except psychology and spirituality. And I was meditating. I think I was 23, at that point. So yeah, from that point onwards, I think I meditated for about 5 years or something like that. And basically, I was doing that pure striving. Like, basically all the striving that I had were really like, get better, you're not good enough. Like, which was projected on work or girls or things like that. I took that and projected that on spirituality. So I was, yeah. So basically, I was, getting up early in the morning, doing yoga, doing meditation, things like that. Like, it wasn't, you could almost say it was not fun. I was really serious about this stuff. Yeah, you probably, remember that. So yeah, from that point onwards, I had, at I think at 27, I didn't, when the things I read then, I didn't really understood what I was reading. I was reading Eckhart Tolle, for example, or Osho, and somehow I got pulled in, but I didn't understand anything. Like, I didn't have any experience, but I was just, I don't know, I was trying to get there or some whatever there was. And then at some point, I had, sitting in the office, an experience of non-duality, you could say, like an experience in which I saw, like, I was suddenly, like, very much the observer. I was, you could say, there, I saw some thoughts somewhere, it's like very far away. And I was, I got up, even though, like, I had some people working for me, I just got up in the middle of the day. I saw the body sort of pack the bag and then walk out, like, and I just cycled away, and I was just watching it. And I was like, this is fun. And basically, I don't remember a lot from that experience afterwards. But what sticks with me is, like, sort of these two things. Like, one, you can just surrender, basically. It's already okay,
It's
basically.
already okay,
And
yeah. Yeah.
exactly. And if I don't think about my problems, they're
Yeah.
not there.
Yeah.
So yeah, from I think that was like 7 years ago. And then it basically, my ego sort of came back, you could say.
Yeah.
And I started seeking again, of course, and a lot of the old patterns, I now saw them, like, and I was like, okay, I need to work on them, right? Instead of like, okay, this is just a pattern, it's fake, right? We don't, it's this is just an idea, right? I thought like I needed to work on that. So basically I became even more serious on the path.
Oh no.
But
But go ahead, sorry.
oh no. But then also like trying to, but then finally when I saw like a text, I understood it. That was because I had felt I had a sort of experience like that. And I think I had a little bit of less like personhood or resistance or whatever. And I started to surrender more and more and more. And I think that led to me at some point, like also learning more about non-duality. And also like for example, Jim Newman or other guys. But before I was more into the traditional like meditation seeking, etc. And I think there's like a lot of benefits to both of that. Like I think there are like when you're seeking, of course, you can seek too much. But when you're just suffering and you aren't seeking at all, it's also, I don't know. It's a sort of balance, in my opinion. I think 2 years ago I had a sort, I had a sort of permanent, I don't know what's permanent, but you know, a sort of Jim Newman would say loss of the contraction or non-duality, basically no center. But then, funny enough, I still felt like it was not done because I had a lot of energetics. I also had a lot of kundalini, and I still have sometimes.
I
So
remember
that,
your message. You said you had a lot of awakening stuff or whatever. I can't remember what you said. Different
yes yes
methods of
well
awakening, but go ahead. Sorry. Sorry
yeah,
for interrupting.
you could say I have had several awakenings. That's how I sort of call it. Like, of course, there's, you could say sometimes you have the like the textbook thing where you had this hit and then everything happened. But I had this like progressive thing where, of course, at one point I lost the center or the person. But then I still notice like deepenings of that, you could say. And I still notice like energetics of that. And that sometimes brought me back to seeking a little bit. And then I saw one of your videos, I think like 2 months ago. And you were talking to, I think, a Scandinavian guy, and you were quite, I think you were quite on fire, you could say. Basically, he was like a hardcore seeker, and you said like there is no one, right? It's just, and he said, well, but I feel like there's a progress, but that's also it, you know. It's like you were very direct, and I love that. And the fact that what you said, like the it's already the case, like really made me realize, like, okay, this whatever this process that this character is going through, which is totally fine, that's it's just a process, it's just an experience in this, you could say, right? So there's no sort of end point to it or something. But there's just experience in this, and I'm glad, or they're glad that there's a nicer experience here. But I don't have to continue seeking. So it's sort of, even though I had like something which most people think, okay, well now I can stop seeking, there was still like this, because it's also a sort of interest or something, like there's never been something else than sort of looking for new optimizations. I started to sort of re-believe in seeking, you could say. So that is that you really cured me of
Oh no, I
that.
did not, but but thank you.
No, but let's say it helped, but I really felt like an experiential, also a lot of sort of clarity. I now feel like more clarity, like, okay, I can trust, sort of, I can trust this, what I'm experiencing. I don't
Trust the
have to.
process, even though there's no process, kind of thing, right? It's just,
You could say, well, I think it's two things. It's either you look from the sort of character experience, and then there's an apparent process, right? And then there is no process, which is like a very beautiful pointer to like the reality of isness, or however you like to call it, right?
Oh, that's beautifully expressed, man. Thank you so much for sharing that. It's so funny, right? Because a lot of, well, most speakers and even teachers will tell you that it's already the case. But what's often heard, right, is that, you know, seekers usually can like hang on to the contracted energy. And that belief in a contracted energy, when there is lightness and then the next day there's a little bit of tightness, then it goes, oh, I'm still seeking. So it keeps on seeking because it makes those statements as the absolute truth or something, right? You know, like a speaker would be saying that. And again, it's neither is right or wrong. It's just what it is.
And funny enough, like not having the contraction made me realize how little difference it have is to have or do not have a contraction. Yeah, like it's really like such a small thing. Like,
yeah,
okay, so who cares? You have a contraction. Who cares? Yeah. Like, right? If it's also, it's not a bad feeling.
No. Again, you know what? Our eyes open, you know, open and closed like 10,000 times, right? I think our lungs, the heart beats like 100. I don't know. I can't remember. I'm not a scientist, but so that's contraction and opening, right? So we don't notice it. Imagine if every time that we breathe or, you know, blink or our heart beats, then we call it something, right? Like an identity. It's like identifying with the heart beats or the breathing or the eyes blinking or the, I don't know, the thousands of appearances of happening inside the body or something, right? When the thought is just one of those, and there's a focus on the thought about contracted energy. So thank you for clarifying that. How is it now, you know, with this seeming easiness, you know, coaching?
That's really funny. Like, it's actually really natural because I was already coaching. And coaching. So most
you
people
do
that
corporate
come to
coaching, right? Corporate
also,
coaching.
So corporate, but also like people that are interested. I tend to attract people that are a little bit interested in spirituality.
Oh, cool, cool. But,
and I also do like people that are like very much into spirituality. But most of the people I see are like entrepreneurs that are just like on the normal grind.
Yeah.
And what it really helps me with is, everything is a belief almost. So when I hear the story, it's like, okay, well, it's okay to have a story, right? You just asked me like, what's your story? I told the story.
Yeah.
But it's if you believe it, if you think it's real, if there's a sort of attachment, you could say, to that story, then that causes suffering. So what I try to do with them is like to sort of wiggle them out of this. And I have some different techniques, but the difference between coaching for personal development, you could say, is that you try to replace a bad belief or a negative belief for a positive belief.
Yeah.
And what I did on my journey, or what I try to do with my clients, is don't replace that belief.
Yeah.
Right? You have a negative belief. You don't need to replace it. You just remove it.
Yeah.
And then who cares about, like, okay, if you want to, you can bring back a positive belief, but actually if you're on the path or whatever, you don't need any beliefs. Get out of there, you know?
Yeah, it's like replacing a lie with a lie.
Exactly. Yeah.
Yeah. Because all beliefs
more
basically
positive
are lies, right? Yeah.
More positive lies maybe makes you feel happier, right? But it's still a lie. Yeah, I agree.
Yeah, it's funny, right? Because I do the one-on-ones, and a couple of people, actually maybe about four now, right, basically are more like the corporate, have nothing to do with non-duality, but they're at the top of their game, so to speak, right? You know, that they have achieved everything. But what they keep on saying is, there's something lacking. What is it, Emerson? So it's, I'm like, I'm not going to coach you on what's lacking, right? Because there's really nothing lacking. By trying to, you know, say that there's something lacking, then it reinforces that there's really a lack. It's just really a thought or a belief, you know, or an idea that something is lacking. And
I try to pull. So I sort of try to pull their belief system out first.
Yeah.
Sort of backseat like tactics. You know, so, and so first I ask a lot of questions. Like if they would say I would lack something, I would say, okay, what would you lack? You know, right? And I would first get into that and then try to sort of, then when I have the full picture, then I can start like, because like most people don't, they get defensive. You maybe have seen that. Oh
yeah,
with their
yeah. When I do
beliefs,
one on
right?
one, right? It's like you've seen
Yeah.
some of them, right? You're like, whoa.
Yeah.
It's the more the when someone comes in there with a big position, right? Even if it's
Yeah.
radical non-duality, it doesn't matter, right? They come in there with
Yeah.
the full-on belief and they don't even believe that it's a belief system. So it's so
Yeah.
ingrained, right? So pulling it out is
Yes.
almost like hardcore, right? It's almost like a
Yeah.
a it's almost like a just a brutal honesty, right? It's just
Yeah, what I sort of one of my teachers on the path talked about, like when you have a sort of energetic, that there's like an energetic investment in a belief as well. So
Oh
it's not
yeah.
only
It's a
like I believe it.
it's an underground belief. Yeah, that's what I call it, like an underground belief, a belief of a belief, basically, right?
Yes,
But you don't even know where it
yeah.
came from.
And it's
But go
like a
ahead,
house
sorry.
of cards. Yeah, and
Yeah.
it's like a house of cards of beliefs also, I feel like if sometimes when you pull one out, like it's when it's at the bottom. So for example, a technique which I love is where you ask somebody how they, for example, they have a certain feeling, and then I go in and I ask, like, how do you like what was the first time that you felt this? And they go back to childhood often, right? Like whether it's not good enough or whatever. And then I say, okay, so this happened to you in childhood, and usually it's a fact, like I don't know, my dad looked away in my basketball game or whatever, you know. And then I say, how did you interpret that? And then they say, of course, not good enough, this and the other. And then you look at it now, and it's like the interpretation is what created the suffering, right?
Yeah, it is. It's just a really flimsy house of cards, right? So if you
Yes.
take away the belief, then everything falls apart. And then
Yes.
even if you
Yeah.
think, if even if you go backwards and who believes that, which is just really a thought, right? So if you take away the thought of that belief, then it falls apart. And then even if you say who thought of that, and then they'll just say that, well, that's me. And then if you look
Yeah.
behind the me, it's just a thought, then it
Yes.
falls apart again. And if you look at why do you believe that, you know, why do you think that there's a me? They're like, well, I believe it. If you take it's just wild, right? Because it's just the structure is so flimsy, yet no one can seem to figure it out because it's almost like a set of belief that is so the truth basically is what they believe at this. Well, this is my truth, right?
Yes.
And a lot of people get caught up in that. And even people get caught up in a belief that there is simply no one. It becomes another belief, right? So, and I think that's
Yes,
what was happening
yes.
to you, right? Because that's why you kept on going back into seeking, right? Because one day I'm like, well, I feel like there's someone here. And then you go back into
Yeah, well,
seeking.
the funny thing is, well, at some point when I sort of lost the contraction, you could say that I was clear that there is no one, but then still I felt sort of, you could say, unpleasant sensations, and you tried to fix, right? So it's sort of, I think that is the sort of balance. Well, maybe you don't agree with that, but let me, I'm curious about your thoughts as well. Like between surrender and non-duality. It's like on one side you have the more masculine side, like this is it, you know, stop making the story, right? And then you have the more feminine thing, like embrace what is, you know, it's also like
Why don't we combine
when
it
it is.
together? Why don't we call it impersonal surrender?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's
Yeah,
a
beautiful,
surrender. It's
beautiful.
just a surrender that happens. You know what I'm saying? So it's a mixture of this is it and a mixture of that softness, the embrace, basically, right? And
Yeah,
yeah,
beautiful.
I had to talk about that. I call it the impersonal embrace, right? Because there's this
Beautiful.
seeming embrace on what seems to appear, kind of like an unconditionality to it. Yeah.
Yeah,
So
and it's yeah, okay, go ahead.
how has it been so far? You know, like it's been a lot of clarity. How do you deal with your relationships with your girlfriend, for example? Do you talk to her about it, or
No. I do share like my experience, but it's so hard to understand for like if you don't experience things like that, it's like, so I think she knows the words that I'm saying, but she's not really understanding what I'm, but It's not necessary because she is also, you could say, she is also it. There's not that, that's sort of, I had this idea that everybody, like, they need all need to go to this process, right? Because it's then they change, but they don't need to change because they're
No,
already it.
they're already it. Yeah, there's not even a
they're
process, even, you know what I'm saying? There seems to be an appearance,
exactly.
but it's already it, no matter what it is. Yeah,
Definitely.
it's one of the reason I think, like about 6 years ago when I started kind of like reaching out, because I really didn't know what was going on anymore, right? It's very isolating sometimes, because although that's just another thought, you know what I'm saying? But it is, because here you are, in this awakeness and everything, and you don't know who to talk to. So I was talking to homeless people that seem to have
Yeah.
some clarity. Yeah, it's just great that there is this wide exposure now on YouTube and other social medias about this, right? And it's be
Yeah.
almost being normalized. It's nothing really, really special anymore, if you know what I mean, right? Before,
I think that's great, actually. Yeah.
yeah.
Because there was a sort of this whole, like, I don't know, probably also when you and I were probably really into this, like, whole the guru, and
Yeah.
so I'm so glad that we don't have to, that is then that's maybe not something that in 20 years is normal in spirituality.
Yeah.
That would be great, like when people are not put on a pedestal, right? Because
I
that's sort of
agree. You know
very,
what?
very anti-teaching,
That's when I was a teacher, that was the most, I was the most uncomfortable with the pedestal, right? And I really loved, the earnestness in helping others and all that kind of stuff like that, right? But when it became a character, basically, like, it looked like a messiah complex, and I was caught up in it, so to speak. Because I was helping people were looking up to me, and there was a huge part of me in the character, anyway, in the story, that was really, really uncomfortable with that. And I think what broke the back of the camel was when someone kissed my feet. Someone from India kissed my feet, and I just, I'm like, no, this is not, although it's also it, but there was this clarity even at that moment that this is going to lead more into hierarchies, into pedestals, right? The moment that you allow the first one, then it will be an excess succession of that. And all of a sudden, you are in the middle of a stage with a robe, with people adoring
You
you.
have a Rolls Royce for every day, like Osho, right? But he, what I like his argument about that, not only about the Rolls Royce, but this whole blowing up and this hierarchy, is funny enough something I understand, but yet it's very wrong. That, sort of, he says, basically, it doesn't matter whether you surrender to God, to me, or whatever, as long as you surrender, it's all it. Basically, that's what he's saying. So that's why he accepted all those gifts, and he accepted the kissing of the feet, and blah, 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 blah. But still, that's still something which I think is very, is not morally correct.
Yeah, well, the way that I see it, right, it's all an illusion, of course, all a dream.
Yes.
But in the dream, there's this dream that seemingly has a timeline, right? This dream seems to have an evolution, so to speak, right? So there is, it's like it took 4 million years for us to speak, right? Or 4 billion years or something. I don't know. I'm not a scientist, but when you have kind of like everything, like, first, we kind of like thought that we were the center of the universe. And then science came along and realized that, oh my goodness, we're not even a speck in the
Yeah.
universe, the
Yeah.
trillions of stars, and we're not even visible. You know what I'm saying? So we're irrelevant, really. And
Yeah.
then with the seeking and everything, in the beginning, right, there was this, prophets and messiahs and sages, and then sages became more accessible. But you would have to go to the cave, you know what I'm saying? Or you would have to go to the ashram and everything. So there was a lot of, seemingly kind of like inequality, right? Because the sage will say, Buddha will say, that everything, or whatever it said, I don't want to repeat something. So the hand down information keeps on being passed on to disciples and followers and seekers, and that seekers start speaking on their own and everything. And then maybe 20 years ago, there was this communication, a radical communication that was very direct and everything. And even up to now, it's seemingly evolving, basically saying, well, there's no such thing as contracted energy yet, really. You know what I'm saying? It's like, and no one is
Yes,
evolving it.
yes.
And it's more direct now, right? Because I get tons of people that are watching one-on-ones that have not even met me, you know what I'm saying? Because it has nothing to do with me, absolutely. That they give this long letters of how the seeking has ended after 30 years, you know, and there was no guru, there was no teachers, there was not even a speaker there. It was just a video.
Yeah, beautiful.
Yeah.
Yeah, if
So,
you videos are amazing. Like YouTube is like, thank God for
yeah. So
YouTube.
we are in the YouTube
Weapon
non-duality
here
era,
is
right?
a God, you know.
Right,
But
where?
the yeah, sorry, go
No,
ahead.
go ahead, go ahead, go ahead.
So yeah, with what I like is like also science when you have like Buddha's talking about like form, you know, and empty fullness,
Yes,
and
yeah.
in science you have like when
Or
you look at
the anatta, that there's no one, no self. But go ahead, yeah.
so you have like a cell, but it's like 98% empty with like a little thing, and that's 98% empty, so you see the form. So that's sometimes how I explain it. Like it's also like scientifically it's also correct, because everything is empty in that sense, but it's also like a form, something you see, an appearance. And it also consists of all these small things, you know? So that sort of already says like everything is energy, everything is already the same.
It is. And if you look at it, right, although even science is a dream, the dream is getting clearer and clearer. And that's what's quite amazing, right? There's really no history. But yet in the history, this history in the making, clarity in the history, there was a lot of basically science that basically you know, that basically has this statement that there's really no time. I'm quite fascinated by science as well, because I've talked to a couple of scientists, you know what I'm saying? And I'm fascinated with AI and simulation and quantum, everything. It's
Quantum
beautiful.
quantum mechanics, quantum
Quantum mechanics,
entanglement.
even determinism, all of this beautiful stuff, you know, but it keeps on showing that there is really no reality. And that's what everybody's trying to touch, right? You know, when they say that there's no time, it's just, you know, photons and quarks, you know what I'm saying, and neurons and everything, and in a and it's just a kaleidoscope of kind of like what the Buddha said, nothing, everything.
Yes, exactly.
Empty fullness.
And that's also like all those philosophers, like for example Nietzsche and things like that, the nihilists, right? They also understood like basically there is nothing, right? There is no self. But then I think what they were lacking is also, but that is beautiful, right? No self is beautiful, because it alleviates all these responsibility, pressure, like heaviness, etc. But they actually saw it as a sort of negative thing, and then they sort of, some of them ended up in as a crazy person, and I think that's also important, like with radical non-duality, like to understand, like, okay,
Like
some people
even
can lose their mind with this stuff if they don't understand or love also in a way.
True. Even radical non-duality is just a construct. There's really no radical non-duality, right? And if you really look at it, and then when the trick is when the character gets super involved in radical non-duality, then they think now in the absolute, right? Which is just another construct. As you probably see with this seeming deepening, although for no one, right? No one knows, right? No one knows. No one gets this. And that's
Exactly. You can't predict the future, basically. You know, you can't, whether there is a future or not, right? But still, you know, that's sort of, but that's what the mind wants to do, right? It wants something to grab hold on and say, okay, so if this is this, then that is that. And then you have a thought that somebody believes in, and then basically you're creating a person again.
That's right. Yeah.
It's
And it
very
just keeps,
tricky.
it's very tricky, but at the same time, it's very simple. In the
Definitely. And
absence
that's
of thoughts,
also,
yeah. No, go ahead. Go ahead. Sorry.
No, that's also the funny thing. Like watching radical non-duality for very long, the message is even simpler than the normal spirituality message, you could say, which creates more, almost more grasping. Either you let go soon and earlier, or you grasp harder. Like there must be somewhere something,
Yeah,
right?
and if you notice what this is probably what happened to you when you kept on going back into that seeking, so you're trying to grasp that there's no one here.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Which just
And
becomes another
conclude something.
dogma. Yeah, and conclude something, you know, or it's brilliant. It's brilliant. Brilliant. Yeah.
Yeah. Now I know something, right? No
Yeah.
self.
No, yeah. And then you become a non-duality police, right? And then all of a sudden, someone will say, "There's no I." What do you mean that there's a me? You know, that it becomes this belief system. And that's what I mean by belief, right? So it becomes this belief system now. And then a non-duality police will say that, well, there's no one to believe. That's just another belief.
Yeah,
It will
then you
just
have
keep
to
on going and going and going and going, right? It's brilliant.
then you have to talk very complicated, right? Because
That's right,
if you
yeah.
have to avoid the word I, then because of course there's no one, but then
Yeah.
in just language, it has always been just a piece of language, right?
That's right.
What I
Let's
tell people, like the word tea has nothing to do with like the cup with like the
the
hot
tea.
stuff in
Yeah,
it,
it has
right?
nothing
It's
to do. Yeah.
not, it's just a word. It's the
Yeah.
word tea. It's an
Yeah.
association. So sort of language has
Well,
effed us up in a way,
it's
you
the
know?
collective reasoning. Basically, what they do is they it selects a couple of phrases, right, and makes it into something that is an absolute truth or something, right? So, for example, the statement will be there's simply no one, but no one knows that. So it omits that no one knows that, and then just focuses on that there's no
Yeah.
one, and it
I think
becomes a
that's an amazing
mantra.
pointer. Yeah,
Yeah.
it's an amazing pointer, but
Yeah.
again, you know, it's just a pointer.
It's
That's
just a pointer.
that's what people
Yeah.
forget, you know. It's
That's
just
right.
you can try as be as correct as possible with language, but
Yeah.
you can't hit it. It's just a
Yeah.
pointer.
Yeah. So I have this new audience that some of the videos go get shared and everything. So it creates a new audience and everything. So I have this different Zoom meetings. The first couple of Zoom meetings, they have no idea what the me is. What they're looking for is their true nature, you know, people from spirituality or people that just had glimpses and no idea what's happening. So here I was with this meeting, and there's a couple, a few, you know, say maybe about four non-duality police in the audience. And then someone will be saying, I've really felt great after that beautiful, I don't know what that was. And I felt like, you know, I was alive. And then while this person was speaking, there was like a whole bunch of comments saying, there's no I. And this person is sharing the most beautiful, you know, glimpse or whatever an experience, right? And someone kept on correcting it. And the person goes, I don't understand. What do you mean that there's no I? Because they have never been exposed to radical non-duality, right? So I explain it this way. Like, so people in a spirituality is looking for that true self or the higher self or the source or the I am or something. And if you look go to the radical non-duality, it's looking for the absence, the dropping away, that there's no me, the no more contraction and everything, which is basically the same. It's just a belief system. And it's quite funny, right? So I had to separate the meetings because I had to have two different newsletters, right?
That's so interesting that that you know the mind or the ego, whatever, finds a new home with like this new lingo of
It does. Yeah.
non-duality, and then tries to say basically he's more enlightened than
There's still a me there. I can tell that there's no one here, but they don't know what they're doing. It's just basically a thought. Me or no me is just a thought. Yeah. And then someone will say, it's not a thought. This communication is not about that, but that's also a thought. There's no escaping it. It's like
No.
every communication is really a thought.
Yeah, it's
Yeah.
not a problem as well. Like
No,
thoughts
and
are,
it's
you
not a
know,
problem. Yeah.
you want to, because like people say, like with meditation, for example, like, well, but I have a thought, you know, it's like, this is, you want to go backwards in evolution, become a goldfish. No.
That's what it is. Well, and if you look at it, right, you know, like our examples basically are, you know, like the stories that we have heard is, you know, like Ramana and Sargadatta, you know what I'm saying? And
Yeah.
during that time, you know, they were trained to be like Ramana, for example, went to an ashram when he was a kid, right? And he was already dressed in a loincloth and, you know, and that was the ashram life and everything, right? So
Sure, yeah.
when I thought that I had to go to India, I started posing around in a loincloth, you know what I'm saying? Like, do I really
That's cold in Canada, man.
like imagine wearing a loincloth in
I
Canada?
mean, I think that would be a
Yeah,
bit
that would
cold.
be the new super enlightened. You're like, oh my goodness, this guy was
Yeah.
walking in minus 30 Celsius in a loincloth. But he
I
died.
found my teacher. I found my teacher.
But he died after 20 minutes, I guess, in
Yeah.
hypothermia. He made it, you know, he made it a, almost a mile, you know, but he was silent. He was
It
silent,
was
you know.
very silent.
He was very silent. We were
Oh, he died? Well, then he's just not a real guru, of course. Yeah.
That's no, but when he died, there was silence everywhere because it was in the middle of a snowstorm, you know, there was snow.
No, well, I do believe it, or believe, well, I have, you know, noticed probably you too, that there are some strange energetics. We cannot really explain it, but there
No one
is
can explain
definitely, you
anything.
know.
Yeah.
So yeah,
Yeah.
you know, I can imagine that some of these stories might be real, but yeah,
Yeah.
who knows? Who cares? It's not, if you read that, it's probably not your journey, right? It's somebody else's journey. And if it happens
Yeah. That's what I
to
mean,
this
right? There's,
character or whatever,
it
yeah.
becomes, you know, like this awakening or enlightenment or dropping away of the me. It's the same thing. Enlightenment, the
Yes.
dropping away of the me is the new enlightenment, basically, right?
Yes.
It's the revised edition of that. The attainment, the no attainment has the new edition of the, you know, but it's still a story, right? So
Exactly,
it becomes a new
yeah.
carrot now, right? The carrot of, you know, dropping away of the me. And then going to Zoom meetings is the new ashram practice now, right? It's like they go to the
Yes.
religiously to this practice of kind of like listening that there's nothing happening over and over again. It becomes the mantra now and everything. So
But it's interesting because
it's
I
not
find
bad. It's
the,
nothing wrong with it. Nothing wrong with it. It's just what it is.
no, but the I mean the non-dual teaching, like, because like, let's say radical non-duality, whatever,
Yeah.
that word is also just, you know, a word, whatever, but that does take some getting used to. When I started, like, from the other spiritual stuff, started like
Yeah,
watching some
I know.
Jim Newman stuff, I was like, this is so cool, but it's so weird. Like, what is this guy?
Yeah.
It's like, and he's, you know, he's quite harsh. I haven't, I he's not like that, you know.
when I first saw the videos, you know what? There was an instant kind of like apprehension. I'm like, what? And there
Yes,
was
what is
also there
this?
who is this smug character, right? You know what I'm saying? And like, and then it was against the grain of everything that I've learned, right? So, but I didn't know that it was just another indoctrination as well, because you're shifting to one to another, which is, and again, you know, it's brilliant. It's brilliant, right? There's beautiful, Jim says really elegant, you know, eloquent stuff, you know what I'm saying, that I love, you know what I'm saying? But when the seeker, you know what I'm saying, hears it and takes snippets of it and forgets the apparently, forgets that this is what's being suggested, then it becomes absolute truth. So I always say it's not really the speaker's intention to create this grand statements and everything. So
No.
what seems to be happening, you know, saying is like I'm hearing more, not even in a radical non-duality more, but from the line of radical non-duality, you know, from that, it's almost like there's a couple of you know, I guess speaking about this that becomes very inclusive now. You know
Okay.
what I'm saying? It's kind of like
Beautiful.
the way that I even open it, I don't know if people are mentioning it. I'm not trying to say that this is better or whatever. It's just a seeming, you know, seeming kind of like there's this direct pointing, but also there's this openness. right?
I love that. I love that. Like for me, like what I liked so much, for example, about the character Jim Newman is like for me, it was I love like I spoke to the guy a couple of times, it was really nice, but the meetings and how things are going sometimes so cringe. Like I cannot listen for over a half an hour, which is great for a pointer because you shouldn't listen like hours and hours. Because so I love the fact that coming from a more inclusive setting that this was sometimes so harsh and maybe so cringe, and I love that because then that sort of shocked me. You could say like the Zen master with a stick, like no.
Nope. But what happens though is when people get slapped, they want to be slapped over and over again.
Oh
So
yeah,
it
the attachment stuff. Yeah, my
so it
yeah.
becomes
Like
a
you said, yeah.
masochist thing, right?
Oh jeez. Yeah. I can imagine anything like that creates more attachment, right? It's also that sometimes the counter is so good. I think that's what maybe hearing from you what you experienced, like hearing a radical non-duality thing for the first time, that was so counter what you had listened to before.
Of it's like the rug being pulled under you, right? You're like,
Exactly, and that works. That the different thing, and sometimes you like with exercise, if you do something you're not used to at all, and sort of that helps the body maybe.
Totally, yeah, totally, yeah. I remember when I tried CrossFit, and I was just like, the hell is this? Right. So I'm used to like yoga and and the
Yeah.
heart the more hardcore thing that it was like handstands, you know what I'm saying? And
Yeah.
like Ashtanga practice, right? It was just like, or like it was just discipline, discipline, discipline. And then you walk into like CrossFit, everyone's grunting and like
Yeah.
with this giant tires, right? And it's like,
Yeah.
like and doing the pull-ups and everything. And you're like at the end of it, you're like puking. You're like,
Yeah.
ah.
So
But that
yeah,
worked. A couple of
that's
weeks, you're like, I'm
that
getting ripped. You know what I'm
yeah.
saying?
Yeah, but I totally agree with the like, when you start to believe in a thought or try to attach to a teaching or not see it as a pointer anymore to emptiness, or to what already is, then basically you forget about it. But there is some sort of getting used to time, like, okay, I get used to the thought that there is no one. But then also the point is for you to experience it and not to listen it. I think that's the new like intellectual seeking is I
Well,
think a
the
big
funny thing
thing.
about the with radical, right, is it's like there's no beginning or ending, but the conclusion of the speaking is there's no one. So
Yeah.
once it's heard that there's no one, that should be
Yes. Yeah.
it.
Yeah.
Then there's
Yeah,
many
that's
additions now that people are like, well, I don't feel like there's no one. So there's the explanation of maybe it's a contracted thing or whatever, which is fine and everything. But when it becomes a cookie cutter thing, even people that don't have any contracted energy, they now are indoctrinated to think that the reason that they don't have, that they still have a me, although there's no me, you know what I'm saying, is because they have a contracted energy when it's just really a suggestion.
Yeah,
There's no such
I
thing, really.
totally agree with you. And sensations, it's like, okay, it's everything that's happening is just a sensation.
Yeah, it
And yeah,
is.
experience it, it's just a sensation. And then when we attach a
We
thought to that
stamp thoughts into
sensation,
it. We label it as
exact.
contraction. We label that as happiness or anxiety or whatever.
Yeah, so contraction, not contraction, that's a sensation. And
It
I
is.
understand, and then there's a something else. There's like sort of self-realization or sort of not self-realization, you could say. And then maybe there's healing, and that's something totally different. And healing might be relevant too, but it's not self-realization. So there, and a lot of healing help already takes place or takes place easier if you see things clearly that there's no self. In yourself and others,
That's right. Yeah, when
because
the
that also
seeking and
tends to be
the
forget.
seeking in in all of the seeking, like consciousness awareness and radical non-duality, I went into a nihilistic phase, right, where I was just really just super depressed, you know what I'm saying, could not get out of my bed, and anxiety, panic attacks, and I hit it, right? So I would hide it by drinking, you know what I'm saying, and just being party animal and everything. But the contrast to that was like maybe a year before that, I was just this, super spiritual person that did not even eat meat or anything, and inhaled prana, you know what I'm saying?
You didn't need food. You left on prana. That's nice. Sorry, I for the people living on prana that I'm laughing.
I ended up getting really sick. I was gaunt. I was gaunt, right? My cheek was like, whatever.
Oh, yeah.
I would not recommend it, right? Because it's
No.
and there's a documentary, I was like researching, I'm like, why did I believe this? Because I bought into it, right? Here I was eating nothing but fruits falling off a tree, and I thought I had to go breatharian completely. And
Breatharian,
of course, you know what? You don't really investigate these things, right? And I went on a deep dive on YouTube lately, and everyone basically that has been involved in the prana is from based on what I saw has been faking it. And
wow.
I was also faking it, you know what I'm saying? But I was not teaching it. At least I was just told people that I'm just going into a deep, silence and meditation, and I'm going to fast. But really, I was trying to become a breatharian so that I would reach my next level of enlightenment, so to speak. I'm like,
Oh,
I don't
yeah.
eat now, you know what I'm saying? So I can see but I could not even take a picture. I could not even show myself to anybody because I really looked like I was just kind of like a crackhead or a crystal meth, you know what I'm saying? Because
How were
my
you feeling? Like, were you feeling
well,
terrible
there
as
were
well?
some times, you know what, the 5, 6 days, when you reach that, you're almost euphoric, right? But that's just chemical reaction seemingly happening. And of course, afterwards, like you're in danger of your. There's a couple of documentaries on YouTube exposing it, basically. The actually one of the most popular kind of like prana person, they actually follow the actually, I think it was in Australia, they actually installed cameras. So the person only lasted 2 days, the first day, since she said that I have to be in nature and everything. So they transferred it to nature. So 3 days while she was not eating in nature, and the doctor said, we can't continue this. It's dangerous. Her blood pressure is high, all of this kind of stuff. So it's dangerous, right? So
Yeah.
even the person that, was supposed to be the best one in this, right?
Yes.
And then
They're still human. They're still human.
they also caught a whole bunch of people that would claim that they have not eaten, kind of like they would have this picture of them eating kind of like a Big Mac or something in a restaurant.
It becomes like very bad if you're also fooling yourself as well.
That's what
Like,
I was
of course,
doing. That's what I was
it's
doing.
very sad
And
if you
again,
fool
no
other people,
disrespect
but
for people that are trying to figure it out and everything, but do use the discernment, so to speak, right? Research,
yes,
research, research. Always type scam or hoax or something. Things will come up, you know what I'm saying?
What let's say, what if somebody hears this and they're like, they're actually suffering, and then they hear this and they're like, okay, just interested in your take, and they're like, okay, so I have nothing to do. Right, this is already it, and yet I'm suffering, right? Maybe there's so how. Let's say somebody poses that question. How do you see that?
When somebody's still suffering, you know what I'm saying, then they're still really caught up in the thoughts. So there's still a lot of duality that seems to happen. Again, there's nothing wrong or right about that, right? So what this is just, I don't know what to call it, but it's the irrelevance of thoughts, and then the peace and the silence is louder than any ideas or thoughts, right? So
So it's
and
like the
every
mental suffering.
yeah so everything is allowed, right? Everything is allowed, nothing is really denied, right? So when prior to this dropping away, or I don't know what to call it anymore, unhappening, I was depressed, and I did seek, some help, right? I was getting some therapy and everything, and healing did happen that way because the character was so depressed and anxious, and it hit it really well that either it was going to be suicide, it was suicidal on point, or get into major addictions because it was just trying to escape things over and over and over again.
Yes,
So I would recommend if someone is suffering and not to put it on one basket of seeking, because that will just exacerbate it, right? Because seeking is futile, right? There's nothing really to find. So seeking help is also it. Seeking physical health, or getting a nutritionist, for example, if somebody's been involved in a, you know, body abuse, basically of eating. Like I was, I'm still paying for it, to be honest with you, right? Like I make sure that I eat really healthy. I run. I have supplements now. I have greens, all that kind of stuff. So there's going to be just because there's no one, it doesn't mean that there's no taking care of the body. It's not a, again, there's nothing wrong or right. You know, someone can go on a, I don't know, go on a drunk binge or something, right? But since there's nothing to escape anymore, for me, for this character, the doing the drugs and, you know, and all that kind of stuff was an escape. So when it's seen really, really clearly now that it's peace. It's really, really at peace. And you know this because I was DJing a few weeks ago, and someone came with like a, they're like, Emerson, this is like 100% Colombian thing. And I'm like, oh no, I'm okay. And they were like, really? I'm like, you would say no to this? And I'm like, no, I'm okay. I'm okay. Because are you?
I think Salvador's Dali said something like, I don't need drugs, I am drugs.
But also, there's nothing wrong if I took it. You know what I'm saying? It's just what is. But there's just this character here that is not escaping anymore. It's just what is, right? So,
Beautiful. Yeah, I agree, like mental suffering, like most of it like is related to a belief or a person that is creating a belief, I mean, what I mean is I think you explained that like something when you believe something, then there's automatically someone that is believing that. Let's say so that me let's say I think, okay, this needs to be done, for example, my taxes, and I believe that it must be done, then there's already somebody that needs to do it as well,
Totally.
right?
Totally. You know what I'm
So
saying? It's
that creates a lot of suffering.
it does. And there's still gonna be some sadness, right? So if someone dies and whatever seems to happen, or someone cheats, that kind of thing, right? Or you have a breakup with someone, there's still gonna be sadness, but there's no more suffering in terms of maintaining what is not. So if there's a breakup, there's
Exactly.
a breakup. It's sad. You know what I'm saying?
And then it's instantly, well, so sort of because feelings and things happen without a filter. I see myself like sort of getting angry or having emotions like on the outside, like instantly without a filter. But then on the inside, I'm like pure calm.
Oh yeah.
I don't know if you have the same experience,
I
but
do,
it's like a mattress of peace. And then my girlfriend said, but you get angry. And I was like, did I just get angry? I don't feel anything, right? Like anger or something like that. I feel nothing on the inside. I feel just peace on the inside. Well, sometimes I raise my voice or something like that.
And that's okay. I was actually right quite worried at one point, because the characters doesn't really get angry a lot. But when I was a spiritual teacher, I got angry a lot. I don't know what happened there, right? Because I was trying to control a lot of things, and I was trying to meditate. So for example, if I would meditate, you know, because I'm trying to not be angry and everything, but once in a while I would erupt into a almost like a tantrum. You know what I'm saying? Like I would get into a tantrum, and only a few people saw it and everything. So I was surprised, you know, maybe about 5 years of not really getting angry. One time I did. Someone was yelling at my dad, like a young kid, right? And I got out. I'm like, "That's my father!" You know, you're yelling at my dad. A parking issue. You know what I'm saying? People get easily heated. And I looked at my dad and I laughed. I'm like, "I got mad. I got angry."
Yeah, but it's also very normal too, I think, when you have a sort of maybe like a first shift or whatever, that you have a sort of deconditioning after that,
Oh yeah,
right?
it's a
Sort of.
complete deconditioning.
So I think, hearing from your story, very similar to my story in a way that you have a sort of insight, but then you sort of you have to live it out. You sort of you know, I don't know, somehow all your shit comes out.
Totally.
Yeah, you
But
need to face it with this new awareness.
we have to do a part two. This is really nice talking to you, Case, but I have another one.
Good luck,
Let's
and it
do a
was really
part
lovely.
two. It's so
Yeah, I'd
good. Let's
love
talk
to.
again soon. Yeah, this is great, man.
Yeah,
Thank you
really
so
fun to
much.
speak to you, man.
Thank you, man. Thank you, Case. We'll chat soon again.
Sure,
Bye.
bye.